Some churches did Epiphany last week, if you wondered, if anybody else said they did Epiphany last week. You get to pick. So I picked the one that was closer to the 6th. So that was today. So today at the church, we're going to take down the decorations and store them. I already put the Sunday school kids to work a little, and we went down and got stuff off the hill. Because we hit a great breaking point, and it was about 9:35, and it kind of looked like it was going to rain. And I said, hey guys, you want to go down and do this? And they were all for it, you know? So. But I am a firm believer in confirmation and Sunday school and so forth. To learn to do things. Where do we score things? Where do we do that? Because that's part of being a member of the church. So anyway, we took care of that. But we're going to take all this stuff down. Now we're going to go downstairs and have a little food and play some games. And it's just going to be a relaxed afternoon. Whoever brought games can sit and play. You can play cards. Play whatever you want to play. I don't care. I didn't mean it that way. I mean, that sounds bad. But you make your choice on what you want to play. And we're having a little fun this afternoon. So, next week is going to be kind of interesting. We have a congregational meeting, and then followed by the Chili and Stew Supper from 3:30 to 6. So we need to have a meeting for the supper committee, just real quick. How about in the first two pews over here? Because I know what's going to happen. We're going to stand here like we always stand, and then people are going to be bringing up the boxes, and we're going to, so. Right over here, just to make sure everything's picked up and ordered and everything for next week. Okay, so when do we want to brown meat and make vegetables and cut up the vegetables? You want to do that Saturday morning? Does that work for people? Saturday morning?
Yeah.
That's fine? Okay, we'll do it Saturday morning. Take care of them, okay? I will pick up the meat because I have it ordered. What time? 9:30? 9:30, okay? Yeah, lets me get at least a little sleep that day. What?
A little sleep? I'm up at 3 o'clock. Let's go.
Do what? Sleep's a fine childhood memory, yeah. But, so we'll just say 9:30, how's that? And we'll prep for it, and then I think Pam has already volunteered. She will stay afterwards and get everything going, maybe one other person, and then and she'll stay. We need a few people to cut some pies and things, but other than that, it goes. This one is not as tough to do. So we'll go by and get some tablecloths this week too, and we can do that on Saturday as well. You pick those up? Okay, I'll like how many we need and so forth, okay? That will take care of that. The 22nd, Reverend Damian Lake, who's our associate conference minister, is coming to visit with us. No reason. He just likes to go out and, well, part of his job is to go visit the churches and see how they're doing. And he has been down into this area a couple times, and I've met with him. And the last cluster meeting we had this fall, he was down, and he said, I'd love to come worship with you all sometime. Just invite me. So I did. And he said, I'll be there. So he's just going to bring, he's going to speak for a little bit and bring greetings from the conference, but it'll be a regular church service. He's just going to be with us. So, but he's a nice man. I like him. And honestly, that's, I don't know if I should say this out loud, but that's, we don't get a lot of attention from the conference, which sometimes is good, but it's nice to know that they're there if we need them. Okay? So, trying to think of anything else that I have missed. I know I haven't done birthdays. Anybody know anything I missed? Seems like I'm forgetting something. Oh, the congregational meeting is next Sunday. I mentioned that. Oh, if you have reports that you need done, please get them to us so we can get them copied, okay? So that we're not copying right
before. Here we go.
So that we're not copying right before the meeting. Which has been done before, but it does make my blood pressure a little bit better if we don't have to do it right after. Test. There we go. Okay. And one last thing before I do birthdays. If anybody comes up to take the Advent wreath apart, just it's going to be a whole lot easier if we light it and let it light, let all of those burn for about 2 minutes and then pull them out. Because then the little things will just twist off and they don't break. So just FYI. Okay. Yes, and please, thank you. And please take your ornaments off the tree today. And this one, I don't know who brought it. Good, I'm not in trouble. Because if I show you the other side, it broke. I hope it wasn't a family heirloom. The day of Linda's funeral, we had to move the tree because of the casket being here. And I didn't realize when you pick the tree up, the three things that hold the tree up, so the legs, fell off. So I set it down over there and the tree went punk. But that was the only one that broke. Everything else is fine. But please take your ornaments off the tree because that will come down today. If you want a poinsettia, that's what I was going to tell you. Take it with you today, please. Some of them are looking a little less than happy. And these flowers over here were left by the family of Kenny Evans yesterday for us to enjoy rather than just to leave them out outside. So, anything else? Birthdays this week. Mark Hansman has a birthday tomorrow. Brian Schenbeck has a birthday this week. George Cosby has a birthday this week. Gary Smith has a birthday this week. Adam Meyer has a birthday this week. And that's all. So we can sing happy birthday to George and Gary. That to your photos. If not, we can help you. I think honestly the best advertisement we get is putting that on Facebook and on social media. That's where people say, overwhelmingly, that's where people say they got it. So I just made a took a picture of it. Okay. Liz, this is for later on. Right there. Okay. Yes. The signs need to be put up for Chileans Do Supper. The signs in the yard need to be put up. So if we can find somebody that will volunteer to do that, we'll see if we can get it.
I'll try to go buy the cash book tomorrow.
Okay. No, we're talking about the physical signs.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you can go buy the cash book and see if we can get that in there yet. That'd be good. Thank you. Somebody with a post or something?
Big hammer.
So we'll talk about that as time comes. Okay.
I'll give it here.
Okay, thanks, Fred. Stand with me for the call of worship today. Darkness is not limited to night skies. Darkness invades our spirits and our souls.
In the darkness of doubt and despair, we have lived until we witness the birth of the Savior.
In darkness of doubt and despair, now that the light has truly come to us,
darkness has been vanished away.
Arise, shine, for the light of God's love has come.
And we shall be led to that light with joy and celebration.
Amen. You bow your heads for the invitation, please. Loving God, who breaks through the darkness of doubt and despair, be with us this day as we hear of the visit of the wise ones, who risk everything to follow a star. Let us open our hearts and be willing to risk receiving the gift of gracious love that you have to offer us in the form of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. She worked 30 years as a librarian at Riverside Regional Library in Jackson, and I have fond memories of Linda driving the bookmobile. Those of us that went to Pocahontas and Fruitland, we didn't have a library, so the bookmobile came out about, I don't know, once a month or so, but it was a highlight for us, and it was always really cool to me because the lady that drove it knew me. Didn't take much when you're little, but she was always special. When Dean became disabled at an automobile accident, Linda stayed home to care for him. Just to tell you a little bit more, those of you that weren't aware that Dean was disabled, he was paralyzed from the chest down. Mm-hmm. And so he could feed himself only with the use of a device that they could slide a utensil into. He didn't have fine motor skills. He could just do like kind of act on the computer, but he could feed himself. But Linda took care of him for many, many, many years. Linda was a member of St. John's United Church of Christ in Fruitland, and Linda was very passionate about decorating the church for holidays and other church occasions. Linda enjoyed attending and watching sports events of her boys and later her grandchildren. And she loved animals, especially her companion, Miss Kate. Linda's the only person I knew who fed the raccoons. She had raccoons that would come up on her back deck and she fed the raccoons. Loving survivors include two sons, Todd Goodson and Jeffrey Jeff Goodson, six grandchildren, Lindy, Grant, Mackenzie, Jordan, Canaan, and Whitney. You can shed tears that she is gone, or you can smile because she's lived. You can close your eyes and pray that she will come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that she has left. Your heart will be empty because you can't see her, or it can be full of love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember her and only that she is gone, or you can cherish her memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what she would want, smile, open your eyes, love. A moment of silence. Those of you that were at the funeral will know that I mentioned that Linda was basically a living saint that shaped many, many of our lives. I'm just taking a moment of personal privilege here because she was our friend for many, many years. Long before I took over as the pastor here or anything else, I've known her since the day I was born. And she's the only person I know that my dad would say she's the only person I know that could take an old towel wrapped around her waist and make it look good. She was always dressed to the nines. She liked her makeup. She liked things certain ways. She loved to decorate. And she's just very special. It's very hard to not see her sitting out there right now. So.
She was always doing wonderful things for people.
She did wonderful things for people. It was so many people that the recipient. I don't know how many of you, I would actually like to know, how many of you were the recipient of a little gift in your car at some point? Yeah. Oh, what am I anticipating? Okay. But some rolls or a book or a card, or she really truly was a living saint that just taught us how to live through her life. And just was very well known. And if you look at her accomplishments in life, they weren't great or grand, but we're going to remember her for who she was because she was truly a good, genuine person.
When Mark was sick, she baked him rolls.
So, and no, they weren't frozen. I suspect that they were frozen for a long time, but I have her recipe if anybody wants them. Yes. Mackenzie sent, we were talking about the rolls with her granddaughter, and about 2 days later, I saw Mackenzie found the recipe.
She had found it. She told me she'd send it to me.
Okay, but she sent us the recipe.
I have the recipe, too.
You do? Okay, so as we get ready for the joys and concerns here, there's a few people I want to tell you about, and some, I'll be honest, I just didn't get to check on this week. This was one of my two really, really, really busy weeks. I worked about 65 hours without the funeral, so I probably did about a 75-hour work week just because I left Wednesday morning at 5:15 and got back at 6 that night, and left Thursday morning about 6:45 and got back after 6, so it just did. We had to get all the student teachers started. And Friday was just spent catching up. Truman, I know, is at Lutheran Home, as far as I know. He's at Lutheran Home, yeah. He's rehabilitating. Daryl is there. I'm hoping Truman and Daryl find each other, maybe. That fellows went home yesterday. He said he would be here this morning, but I got the feeling the daughters intervened on that. But he was in good spirits. I talked to him Friday afternoon after I found out he was in the hospital. They don't know, he's got some follow-up appointments. His heart, and don't take this the wrong way, his heart is at about 35% function, but your heart is only at about 60% at full function. Because 60% means you can exercise and get your heart. I mean, if you were at 100% and you had to exercise, you'd be in trouble, okay? Because there would be no place. So it's only about 60%. It's not uncommon as you get older for your heart function to go down. They did give him some medication to try to push that back up. He really thinks and so did his daughters, that it may have been some gastrointestinal issues, some indigestion and GERD that may have caused some of the pain and the heart issues as well. And if anybody's ever had any of that, it can, I've got a hiatal hernia, so yes, it can cause some issues with your heart. The funeral for Kenny Evans was held yesterday morning, and the burial was here. I worked with the family. They didn't want a meal, primarily because they knew Kenny had not been here for many, many, many years, although he found this church very special. But also they had no idea who would stay and who wouldn't, because this very, very little family left. There were five Evans boys, and there's only one left now. But out of those five, there's only like four or five nieces and nephews. And Ted, who is still alive, did not come down. He's in Michigan. He's in good poor health. And then his family, in turn, didn't come either, because he didn't come. So there were really only two nieces, one nephew, and one great-nephew and one great-niece, I think, here. But I work with Tammy and Steve Overman. If anybody knows them, that's Kenny's great-niece. And we decided on coffee and cookies after the burial, just because we weren't sure if it would be family, if other people would stay. And she didn't want us in a position of having to do like planning for like 15 people and have 45 stay. Because her guests would have been about 15 with family, so we decided on the latter. So, and it worked out very well. Keep the Goodson family in your prayers. Continue to keep them. Keep the Evans family, and we will do Kenny's memorial service next Sunday. Okay. And then keep Mary Pitcher's family in your prayers. Mary's brother-in-law passed away, and they are, I can't remember, he and Olathe, was it?
Oswego.
Oswego. I was close.
Yeah.
I know, right? Okay. Oswego, Kansas. I assume was your mom's sister's husband?
Yeah, my mom's sister is Mary Dickerson, so it's a Gene Dickerson.
That makes a lot of sense, because I've been trying to figure out how all those Dickersons are married.
Yeah.
Two of them Mary Dickersons, okay.
Yeah, two of my mom's sisters Mary Gene Dickerson and Lynn Dickerson, and that's how there's like a big chunk of our family are all Dickersons. So.
I just kind of wondered.
Yeah.
So, anybody else that we need to remember at this time?
Jim's younger brother in Iowa has been put on hospice and all. So, and I would just ask for prayers for our entire family. Chris and Bill are not here. That's all I'm saying. But
okay. I talked to them yesterday, and they were planning to be here. So somebody's probably not feeling well or something. So.
I was denied for the patient assistance program for my medicine. That I've been on for the last 6 years. So please pray that tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon sometime at the pharmacy in Poplar Bluff at the Kroger that they have my medicine, because I run out Tuesday morning and I have to have it. And through a whole bunch of negotiations and whatever, it's either going to cost me $571 or $10. We don't know.
But the full price is $1,700.
No, $2,300.
$2,300. Full price is $2,300.
So pray that it's there, and pray that it's 10 and not 571. But I've got to have it, so just pray that it's there.
It's been a long week in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Anything good happened this week? Kids, I went back to school. I know that was just a joy for them all.
The new train schedules were on the website.
Yep, they open up today for the,
yeah,
the Santa trains.
Tomorrow,
don't they?
We'll be on the tomorrow.
Okay. Don?
Our great-grandson, who plays with the Jacksonville Jaguars, they won their division last night.
Yes.
So good for them.
That's exciting.
It's always strange how something a professional player has a connection to St. John's. I did a whole section on what these student teachers don't talk about anybody. Because everybody knows everybody who knows everybody, and they're all interrelated. I won't tell you the story, but I walked into the place in St. Louis where we're having the meeting. Out of all the people in St. Louis that morning, I knew the young lady sitting at the desk. And she knew me. We had just not put it together because she got married and her name changed. Anybody else? Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we come to you this morning in a time of epiphany, a time that we should look for those bright stars, those things in our lives that lead us to you, like the wise men led us. Father, we come celebrating this Christmas season that is over, and with all the memories that we had. And we pray that you'll let us keep some of that spirit in our hearts as we move on. We pray that you'll be with each that we mention that need prayers, whether it be for healing or comfort or sorrow. And pray that you'll be with all of them. Father, we ask you to continue to bless this church. We ask you to continue to bring people to us and to let us seek your guidance on the ways that we need to continue. Father, bless us next week as we have our congregational meeting, as we discuss business and things, and bless us this afternoon as we just have some fellowship together. Father, we come to you as a sinful group of people, knowing that all too often we allow things to just overtake us, and sometimes we sin because we just do it. And Father, we ask you for your forgiveness at this point. Father, we continue to come to you seeking your will, knowing that you have a purpose in mind for all of us and letting us know that purpose. We ask this all in the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I did forget to mention, continue to keep the Lenneke family in your prayers too as they adjust to Joyce's passing. So there was a lot that happened right at Christmas. There really was. So. Children's sermon and special music is off the mind today. Because I found something the other day that I did not know. But anybody know like James Taylor, his music? Okay. Well, one, they played a James Taylor song at Kenny's funeral yesterday. They played Fire and Rain, which if you listen to is very appropriate, okay? But in looking up that song and so forth, I found out that James Taylor, of all things, wrote an Epiphany song. Now, how many songs do you know were written specifically for Epiphany? Okay? Well, he wrote one. And if you listen closely to the words, it says something about I'm here tonight. So I suspect he wrote it for a concert that was held on Epiphany. The point being, though, is we don't recognize why Epiphany. We just say it's the day that traditionally the wise men came. But the point of it is the fact that when the wise men got to see Jesus, no matter whether it was 12 days or 2 days or whatever, they were the first non-Jewish people to recognize Jesus as the king, as the Messiah, because they came from different parts of the world. And so that's the true significance. The song is called Home by Another Way, though, and just listen to the words, and it talks about how they were warned in a dream to go home by another way. So just listen to this song, please. Sure, enjoy the next day.
to sing this song tonight. They tell me that life is a miracle, and I figure that they're right. The parents always out there. He's got a card on file. It's a lit bike since if you're giving it. The hair doesn't take a while. It's best to go home.
Set on the way we're supposed to go. God wants us to go home by another way. And I've listened to that song several times since I discovered it. I like it. Nobody else liked it, but I just like James Taylor. But one of the points that point, one, a couple of things that really stood out to me, and this was kind of the children's sermon points of it. There's a line that said, if Herod will slaughter the innocents, don't think he'll cut a deal with you. And so be wise. What people, their actions speak louder than their words. And now I can't think of the other one for the life of me. But basically, just don't be afraid to follow the path that God lays out, because the wise men were thinking one thing and they had a dream and they went home a different way. They changed their plans so that Herod wouldn't know what was going on. So I just thought that was an appropriate thing for Epiphany today. So if you would, open your hymnals to 293. You can stay seated. We're going to sing Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness. We'll sing all three verses. Scriptures this morning from Matthew 2, 1 through 6, and then Matthew 2, 10, and then from Mark 1, 9 through 11. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who's been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." And when King Herod heard, he was disturbed, and all Israel, or all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. And in Bethlehem, Judea, they replied, "For this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." And I think I've mentioned before, but if you're not familiar, Bethlehem was, and Fruitland was pretty much a metropolis compared to Bethlehem. It was very small. So it was surprising, not only that God slipped the baby Jesus into a manger in an unknown kind of birth, but he slipped him into an unknown kind of town, to Bethlehem. Now we hear Bethlehem, and it was the part of the birth. It's a big deal, but back then Bethlehem was nothing. It was just a white spot in the road. Matthew 2:10, "When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. And they opened their treasures and presented him with gold, gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh." And at that time, and from Mark, "At that time Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, 'You are my Son, and my love, with you I am well pleased.'" And that last scripture is about the water part. You know, the title is Gold Stars and Water, but it actually is the transition for us this morning, because the Sunday after Epiphany, which is what the liturgical calendar calls the baptism of our Lord, because you immediately go from Epiphany into Jesus' being baptized in the beginning of his ministries. And people think that's kind of weird. Well, that's because there's not in the Bible a lot about Jesus growing up, other than one story when he was 12, or we think around 12, when he was a child and was left at the temple. Other than that, there's just not a lot in the Bible about Jesus' life. So, I don't know how many people here are like me, but I love to go out on a cold winter's night and look up at the sky. Anybody else like to look out? Look at the stars and so forth? Okay. It's a beautiful sight. I even have an app on my phone that will identify things. So if you drive by my house and I'm standing out in the yard doing this, you'll know what's going on, because it will kind of live show you this, "Oh, what's that bright star?" And you can hold it up and they'll say, "Well, that's Saturn," or "This is Jupiter," not Jerusalem, Jupiter, not Jerusalem, Jupiter, and it will show you all of the different constellations and things like that. Now, I don't know if anybody's ever been around somebody who grew up in a very, very urban area, New York or the inner St. Louis or something like that. They have no idea how many stars are out there, because even though they go out into what they call a rural area or like a park and they say, "Wow, there's a lot of stars out there," it is nothing to like being downhill on the hillside or over here on the hillside at night with no light pollution around. You see so many stars. We notice all kinds of things. And sometimes we just take for granted the stars are out there. Okay? How many people take for granted that the sun comes up and goes down every day? Sometimes we'll say, "Oh, what a beautiful sunset," but it just happens. The stars are there. But noticing the stars and going out and looking at them means you have to notice something with intent. And to do that, that's called intentionality. And that means you go outside and you intentionally look up and look for that star. Okay? During COVID, what was going on, though, that was the time when those different planets aligned. And there were a lot of people out or post that noticed those kinds of things. Okay? Because they went out and looked intentionally at it. Many people do not like going outside in the dark. Okay? They want the light there with them. Okay? Now, I have to say, right before we got married, Pam was up at my mom and dad's house one night, and it's, "God, it's dark out here." Okay? Which is fine, because when I went to Canada, I said, "God, it's flat down here." You know, it's just what you're used to. Okay? And I didn't think it was that dark, because I was kind of used to it. Okay, as a matter of fact, when I first moved to Potosi, I had trouble sleeping the first couple of nights because it was just too light. There was too much light there, you know? And some of you are laughing, you've grown up out in the country, and you get used to things, right? Darkness does make us uncomfortable, though. Okay? I don't know anybody, when we talk about being scared of the dark, I'm not necessarily scared of the dark, but after a while, you get kind of tired of sitting in the dark, don't you? That's why we light candles and things, because there's not a whole lot to do in the dark. thinks it wasn't playing on my phone or whatever. Well, no, not if it's dead. Think of the people years and years ago, like in Jesus' time, if they didn't have a fire. There's a book by William Manchester called A World Lit Only by Fire. And it talks about during the 13, 1400s when the world literally, the only light they had was fire. Okay? And that was during the day, it was sunshine, which is fire. And at night, they had to build a fire in the fireplace, they had to burn candles, they had to do some kind of oil or something. The only light they ever had was fire. It's a very interesting book, but it's kind of beside the point. Epiphany reminds us that dwelling in the darkness and looking up in the vastness of space is where we actually find the star that leads to Jesus. An epiphany calls us to look past our small little worlds and at the whole of creation redeemed by Jesus' coming. And so I said the real significance of Epiphany, often people just say it's the wise men coming and worshiping Jesus. The true significance is that they were non-Jews. Up to that point, even King Herod was Jewish. The people were all Jewish, and they had all looked through the prophecies and so forth. And all of a sudden, you've got these people who are usually, and we did a sermon on this last year, but usually one looks Ethiopian or black, one looks a little Oriental, and one looks like Arabic. Okay? It signifies that this was going to be open to the world. Okay? And people of non-Jewish backgrounds had read the prophecies of their own religions and said, there's a king coming. Okay? The Magi were the big picture guys. They realized that something was happening in the world because they followed the star. We don't know how far they followed it. We don't know how it led them, but it led them. And I actually called Lydia and had her bring this book. It's out of print. It's extremely rare. It's called The Revelation of the Magi, The Lost Tale of the Wise Men's Journey to Bethlehem. And so it's basically a lost book of the Bible that was never included in the Bible, but it's The Revelations of the Magi. And the reason I had Lydia bring it is because guess where I got it? Lydia gets it. We talked about it one time in a Linton study, and she put Pam on the path that Linda wanted to give me this book. Okay, so she gave me this book, and if you want to look at it later, that's fine, but there's some pictures in here, because it points out this is supposedly the writings of the Magi. Okay? And there's some interesting things in here. You'll notice here, like, here's the star and so forth, but they talk about that the star shone all the time. It was always shining, but not everyone saw it. Only the people that God wanted to see it saw it. And so it went ahead of them all day and all night. Didn't you ever wonder what they did all day? I mean, when you think about it, you talk about following the star, well, what did they do all day? Okay? It said sleep. I guess that's true. But it said the star went ahead of them. Okay? And led them. But it led the shepherds as well because God let them see it. Bible doesn't record it, and I don't know the truth on all this, but it makes sense because the Bible doesn't record, and history doesn't record that thousands of people went to Bethlehem to see what this huge star was about. It just records a few people. So it's an alternate theory or whatever, but it's actually their description of traveling with a star. And so that even sometimes the star had a baby. You could see the baby in the star. And so they knew they were looking for a baby, which it's interesting. Okay? Matthew 2:10, when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And on coming to the house, they saw the child and with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. And they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And we've talked before that frankincense and myrrh are precious ointments that are meant for anointing and embalming the body, and they were very prophetic gifts, prophesying what was going to happen to Jesus. And it makes you wonder if Mary used any of those when Jesus was crucified. Did Mary go back and say, we were given this when he was born. We need to use this. But I want to talk about gold for a minute. Because gold is still an incredible gift. Okay? You give me a lump of frankincense right now, I'm going to say, well, how nice. You give me some gold, I'm going to say, ooh. Because, like it or not, gold is currency. And we don't live without some kind of currency. Some people are caught up in money and everything. Well, whether you like it, you got to have some money to live. Right? Even if you grow your own food and you do all that, you got to have some money to go on. It just the way it is. Right? And it's recorded that Mary and Joseph were not a wealthy couple, that they were just a standard, ordinary group of people that lived kind of in the Nazareth area. So was this similar to giving like a savings bond to a baby when they're born? Because gold usually goes up in value. Okay, now gold's got dips and rises and dips and rises, but gold is a pretty good gift to give because it doesn't really change a whole lot. Diamonds are the best because diamonds have never went down. Anybody knew that? Diamonds don't drop. Diamonds just kind of continually rise. But was God preparing them for some way? Was God seeing for them? Because shortly after Jesus was born, well, some people would say it was up to 2 years, so again, we don't know. But Mary and Joseph had to take Jesus to Egypt because they were born. Herod's going to send somebody to try to kill him, and they took Jesus to Egypt. Well, you know what? We're going to Egypt. It cost us a lot of money. Okay? It doesn't matter where you go. It costs you a lot of it costs money. Okay? If you hop in your car and drive over to the Dollar General, that may not be a big deal to you, but it still costs a little money. Okay? I'm used to my little Prius, okay, which I get like 58 miles to the gallon, and I got a rental car for Wednesday and Thursday and part of Friday because that's what you have to do if you go over 35 miles at the university. You get a rental car. Well, I got an Explorer, and it was nice. Okay, until I filled that thing up, and thank God I had a single credit card because I didn't want the $68 worth of, you know, I actually go for like 3 weeks before I fill my car up, and that's like $18, you know, or something. But I'm like, well, this is really a nice vehicle, and then I'm filling that thing up. Like, is this thing ever gonna stop? The point is though that it takes money to get to Egypt, and it took money in Egypt to live. Because even when they got there, Joseph may have been an incredibly skilled carpenter, but you had to stay someplace till you got a job. Okay. I'm sure Mary and Joseph appreciated the frankincense and myrrh, but the gold was the practical gift. The gold was the one that made traveling easier. It put food on the table. And it was also a reminder to us that Joseph and Mary and Jesus were just a real ordinary family for many years. Okay? They struggled the same way we struggle. And Mary and Joseph were raising God's son. That didn't come with any special perks. Okay? They still cooked meals. They still worked for a living. They struggled with the daily frustrations of life. Wouldn't you think if you were chosen to raise God's son that you could, like, take it easy? He would provide for you? But, no, they were ordinary people. And there was a reason, because if God's son stood out in any way, it would endanger the whole plan. God could not afford to have attention brought to Jesus. So Jesus lived a very, very ordinary life. He had a very ordinary birth. But now that we look back on it, it was an extraordinary birth and an extraordinary life. But the point being is it had to be ordinary for everything to work. An extraordinary life that was revealed 33 years later. And in Mark 9, our 1, 9 to 11, as that time Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love, with you I am well pleased." Now think about the water. We baptize with water. And some of you may not know that we did a baptism here last Sunday. I baptized my great niece. Right after church, my name is Josephine June Singers, and it was very sweet. Did it here, and they were all worried because she laid down in front of the altar and was running around. So why? You know, it's a big deal. She's a kid. She's two. But it all turned out very nice. Okay? So in the last 2 weeks, I said we've done 2 funerals and a baptism. So it's for a small church. We've been kind of busy. But think about the water. Water is powerful. It's life-giving. Also life-threatening sometimes. We cannot live with it. Okay, we cannot live without it, I'm sorry. And we can't take water for granted. More and more we hear about the benefits of drinking water. Now, I'm lucky. I love water. I have drank water all my life. I've always been a water drinker. Pam hates water. Doesn't like water. Okay. Linda didn't like water. It was trouble. So they had to keep her trying to drink. But a lot of times, one of the issues in the hospital is pushing the water. Is there a more versatile substance on the face of the earth than water? It is incredibly corrosive. We may not think so, but look at the Grand Canyon. Over time, it is incredibly corrosive. Not only the power, but the acidity. There's a little bit of acidity in it, okay? It will, over time, break things down, okay? Leave some water standing someplace for about 2 weeks. What's it do? Get stagnant sometimes, okay? Plants have to have water to grow, but too much water does what?
Kills them.
Okay? It's the most versatile compound on earth, and yet it's the most common liquid on earth. You can find water about anywhere. And yet, it is what God chose to symbolize the utter cleanness that Jesus would be bringing. He could have chosen something really rare and unique. He chose water. Jesus was washed in water. The lesson learned from the stars, the gold, and the water is that sometimes we need to look in faraway places. We need to take a trip into the dark. We may go home by another way. I'll make that tie in there. Maybe we need to go home by another way. Maybe it's a little darker that path, but we may need to do that. We need to look for a star, or at least a light, to guide us. We may need to realize that following Jesus may take us out of our small, safe, comfortable little living spaces. Small, safe, we like our homes, we like our spots. But once in a while, you stay there too long, and you start stagnating. We may need to expand our views to look at all of creation, not just the few feet in front of us. We talk at the university sometimes about some students who have small world syndrome. You know, we're not making fun of them. We're just saying they have always kind of lived in the same place and never really traveled much or done anything. And you can kind of tell, Carol's smiling, you can kind of tell when you send them out to a different school. They're like, oh, I couldn't believe, da, 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 da. And you're like, well, that's because you've only been to one place. All right? We need to remember that the Magi that brought gold and tied the ordinary life to the extraordinary life. And we need to remember that no one is too dirty, too thirsty, too hardened, or too far gone to be off limits for the waters of baptism. Today we transition from Christmas to ordinary time. In some ways it's kind of sad. We took down our tree yesterday. Actually, we leave our tree up to fellow pitching at home. It's just our tradition. But we took down the tree yesterday, and it was kind of sad. Actually, I got up early and took it down before they got up because they don't like to do it. Okay, they're sad. And I had it all done and put away. And thinking, oh. But it's amazing how quick we get used to it not being there. Okay, we're back into our ordinary again. We can see the TV from the living room or from the kitchen now because the tree always blocked the TV and those kinds of things. We need to remember that in God, the plain sometimes becomes extraordinary. And that's what this Epiphany season is all about. And Epiphany means big idea, big awakening, new things. Remember to look at the plain stuff and let your heart awaken to something new. Amen. Let's open our hymnals to 292. And we're going to sing a song that Carol said has lots of accidents. If you don't know what an accidental is, Carol will explain it. So stand with me. Out of sleep thy throne. Let's sing the first and last.
Oh, God, to my heart, Lord Jesus.
stay in health, it would be greatly appreciated. If you can't, we understand, but don't forget that we're having lunch and snacks and play some games this afternoon. May the light of the star, the light of God's love, shine before you as you leave this place. Go in peace, go in joy, go in love to meet God's people in the world and greet them with the good news of salvation. Amen.